So, you got on the website material the Poland set last time, and the slides. I can provide to you the slides in better resolution in case you need them or you want to have a little bit nicer looking pictures, like the resolution I provide. It's in just a 3 megabyte file or something that you can easily download. The bigger one is, I think, 20 megabytes. So if you're interested, I can also give you a better resolution file of the lecture. Then we also added notes of the lecture, very brief notes, but the key images that I showed you are commented on in regard to the biology you see there. And then I also made available to you, that will be relevant today, my quantum mechanics notes from which we utilize material from chapter 8 that I will be teaching about today. And then there was an review chapter that introduced the purple bacteria photosynthesis system, and that gives you a nice overview. So there's a lot of material. I don't think it's really absolutely necessary that you work through all of it. But if you want, if you're interested, you you certainly can benefit from it. So you might want to have a quick look, and maybe it interests you, maybe if don't, then just keep it to the normal graduate course level, what you want to learn from, in addition to what is presented in the classroom. So today we have a more conventional class. We speak about the quantum biology of photosynthesis, particularly of the bacterial photosynthetic system that we encountered last time. I will first give an overview of it, and then we go into the physics. So, though the lecture then today is quantum biology, bacterial, actually write purple bacterial, because there's also the other bacteria that have a slightly different photosynthesis. So we had a membrane that was actually spherical, but I draw it here planar. In fact, in some species, you also find that the photosynthetic membrane is actually arranged in a planar way in the cell, because it might fit better into the cell. So some bacteria have hundreds of spheres, and some of them have what you call lamella. They organize the membrane like this, always flat. And you know, there are many animals in the zoo, and there are a lot of bacteria out there, and so nature tries all kinds of architectures. So here we have our membrane, and it all begins with with a protein that we called LH2. That contains 18 bacterial chlorophylls and 9 carotenoids, and it absorbs light, and the light that is in the habitat of these bacteria is mainly 500 nanometer and 800 nanometer light. These two types of photons are absorbed by these molecules that I draw you quickly, and carotenoid. Is a molecule that looks, if I put it in a plane, so this is a X and this is Y, then the molecule looks like this and goes on. So it's a zigzag molecule that has here carbons and then hydrogens. The hydrogens and the carbons are placed in such an obvious way that every first year chemistry student knows exactly where they are, so you usually don't even draw them. So very often you draw this one just as a zigzag line, saying that every vertex is a carbon, and you just figure out with the rules of chemistry how many hydrogens you have. Okay. So this is a carotenoid, and the bacterium chlorophyll, this absorbs 500 nanometer light, but not just a sharp line. It's not like a sodium atom that has a very, very sharp absorbing and fluorescent light, but rather it is what is called the Boy Scout salute spectrum. I don't know if how many of you are Boy Scouts, and when you salute, you show the other Boy Scout your fingers, not the finger. And so it looks like this. It's a spectrum around 500 nanometer. And so it's a little broader. The feature that you see there, we will look at into this briefly, is due to the vibrations of the molecule that add and subtract energy from the electronic degrees of freedom that come with the molecules and that are mainly involved in the light absorption. So this is a carotenoid, and then you have the chlorophylls. In our case, they're bacterial chlorophylls. The difference between bacterial chlorophyll and chlorophyll, I'm not going to draw you. This is a very schematic carotenoid. They are usually varied a little bit in length. Sometimes you also have heteroatoms, not just carbon. Sometimes you have a ring. And so this is just a standard. And now here the chlorophyll standard is square with pentamers. And inside of this ring, you call this one a pyrrole ring. So you call this one then a tetrapyrrole system. Inside of the tetrapyrrole system sits, in case of chlorophyll, a magnesium ion. And the magnesium ion is then interacting here. And here you have at each vertex you have carbon, and then you also have some hydrogens that I don't draw. And now you have the chain here that holds the thing into place, and then sometimes you have an extra ring or heteroatoms that optimizes the chlorophyll for the habitat, and accordingly you call it a plant called chlorophyll or bacterial chlorophyll, and I don't know how many chlorophylls there are, but pretty sure there are about 20 different chlorophylls that you find in the different organisms. Now this is the system with the magnesium central ion that that absorbs visible light. In this case it absorbs light around 800 nanometer. It has actually two two absorptions, and then it had later another absorption at lower. Lower is about, I think, 400 nanometer or something like this. So we've seen the spectrum, and so here you have two electronic excitation. One is called QY, and one is called QX, and this one is called the Soré band. And so these are the electronic excitations, and here we have actually also many states. Here we see only one state, and if we put here, the energy of the system, maybe delta E, the absorption energy, then we have actually here many states. So we have, I usually draw it upside down, not like this, but let me go like this. Then, but the energy goes here in this direction, so I don't do it like this. It's not very, very, very instructive for you, so I can also go like this. And so the way the energy goes is that we have one state that is a good absorber, and there's another state that is also an absorber. But then we have many, many states that I maybe draw by points. They don't absorb at all light, but they're electronic excitation. So some electronic excitation, just like the 2p state of an hydrogen atom, light to absorb light, whereas the 2s absorption state doesn't absorb light when you start from the 1s state of a hydrogen atom. It's optically forbidden. And so similar in these molecules. Okay, so these are the molecules. Now I just like to comment that the chlorophyll and the magnesium, but they're also these tetrapyral rings with other atoms. And for example, there's one which doesn't have any atom, central atom, then you call it pyrophytin. And then there are some where you have an iron atom inside, and then you call it a heme group. And the iron atom can actually be in different states. And so depending on what kind type of iron atom you have, or if you don't have an atom, or you have magnesium, you not only have different absorption characteristic. For example, you have heme, a lot of heme in the blood that makes the blood look red. But it also is very important for the electron conduction characteristic, which you remember is also key to the quantum biological mechanism of photosynthesis. We had light absorption and we had electron conduction. And so this one is here very much steered by the same kind of molecule, but with different central atoms. Okay, so these are the molecules, and we find the one with the magnesium and the carotenoid inside here. See quite a few of them, and they absorb the light, and they are the spectra. And now, once they absorb the light, maybe write it here. So initially we have light absorption by carotenoid or bacteriochlorophylls. And then we have a second process where the carotenoid gives the energy to the chlorophyll. That is possible because if we go here to this molecule and we look at the positioning of the chlorophylls, then they are positioned typically like this, very close together, pairwise, and those are bacterial chlorophylls. And then we have one that is actually perpendicular. So this one is here, if we call this one X and Y, then this one would be Z then. So in the third direction. And this would be the chlorophylls. And now we have, for each three of these guys, we have a carotenoid. So three bacterial chlorophylls, one carotenoid. And the carotenoid is touching the chlorophylls and thereby interacting with them at close range. And you know from the electromagnetism that when charges interact with each other, then you have two regimes. You have the near field regime and you have the far field regime. In the far field regime, you can do multipole expansion. So when you look at the interaction between two static charge distributions, then you just look at what is the net charge in one and the other. That is the dominant term, the Coulomb term that comes from that. The next term would be a dipole with a charge or a charge with a dipole. The next term would be a dipole with a dipole. And so you can do this in the far field. In the near field, you cannot do that. You have to just really look where all the charges are and sum them up correctly. And so here the near field transfer. Because the molecules are very close. And I told you that this is an extremely rapid process, namely 100 femtoseconds. And if we look at the excitation, then we find that on the carotenoid side, we have an absorber, but then we have also states that are forbidden, that don't absorb. But when we excite the molecule, this is a ground state, the lowest energy state. If we excite it through a photon, then the system rapidly goes to these lower states because they're so close that the energy just goes there very, very rapidly. The way you can change just the level in a molecule is by giving the excess energy to the vibrations of the molecule. And the closer the levels are, the less vibrations you have to generate. And so then this is faster. So you do it very fast, and this one is actually something that is that happens in 50 femtoseconds. And now here we have our chlorophyll, QX and QY. So this is here the ground state, and this is the chlorophyll. And now we can transfer the energy here. We can transfer the energy here. We cannot transfer the energy from here to here, from here to here. That is due to the quantum mechanical behavior that if you have two levels that interact with each other, two states, then they only interact with those states that are energetically close. If the interaction energy is small, and the interaction energy is small here, so there's an interaction between the carotenoid and the chlorophyll, pretty good, but if you look at it in absolute value, it's small, and so they only interact with really levels that are just basically isoenergetic. So they go here, and you see you have to do it very fast here, because this goes very fast. You have to do it very fast here, because also this is very fast. This is not quite femtosecond, but it's much less than a nanosecond. And so, so this is how you can transfer the excitation. Okay, so this is step two, and step three is that the chlorophylls are individually excited, and they are now sharing the excitation between a group of n of them, who are getting communally as a group excited and in a coherent fashion. So here we have an individual chlorophyll, and here we have a ring of chlorophyll. Now I'm really challenged to draw that well, but if I want to do it, I do it like this. So I'm not good in drawing, but maybe you get it sort of. They go around the ring, and you have in this ring you have. Sorry, I made a mistake here. I miscounted. I said 18. I should have put 27 here. Sorry. And here you have 18 chlorophylls in this ring, and you have actually. 9 other chlorophylls above the ring. That was a mistake of mine. Sorry. Okay, so now you are having this one excited, and now you are share the excitation between them, and now you're getting them all excited. And there's a conservation of number. If you have here one chlorophyll can have one excitation, then 18 chlorophylls can have 18 excitations. So the excitation are not just simply all the same excitation. So if this one is a single chlorophyll excitation, then these excitations here will spread around. They form a band of excitations below and above. So the single line, but there are many of them altogether, then 18, and those excitations you call an exciton, the shared excitations. And so now this one becomes an exciton. This is a process three. And process four is then that an exciton from LH to molecule 1 goes to an exciton from LH to molecule 2. So you have one of these ring molecules, and here you have the next ring molecule. And the excitation moves over. This is a far field process that is dominated by dipole-dipole. Interaction. So if you look at what kind of Coulomb terms they hold, then now you have. You can do a multiple expansion, and since these excitations don't have a net charge, there is no charge-charge interaction. The lowest term that contributes is a dipole-dipole interaction. So this is how far we got now. And now we go now from here to the next LH2, and now we go from here to a much bigger ring, namely the LH1 ring. So this is also an LH2, and here we have now an LH1 ring. The LH1 ring is filled with chlorophyll. They were actually in the figure that I show you, that you can, that you saw last time, and that you can see on the website, and on maybe hopefully by now also on your laptop, is actually a dimer. You see two rings close together, but that's not really essential. It's just a dimer. There are some reasons, but the reason is not very essential at this point in my lecture, and so I don't even have to talk about it, right, the dimer. And so we have now here, the excitation goes now from LH2 to LH2, and then it goes to LH1 in a far field, with a far field interaction, and then it goes from the LH1, it goes to the reaction center, where we have in the center of the reaction center at the bottom two chlorophylls. Actually we have more chlorophylls, but here we have two chlorophylls that are really important. So maybe I put them, not two, but I put a square there. So I have two of them. They get excited. And they are now utilizing the energy to transfer electrons. One by one by one, but essential for the following is that they do that in steps of two. So they put two electrons here, and that was the next step. So we transfer the excitation, and once it arrives at the reaction center, the excitation is utilized now for electron transfer. So this is electron transfer. We write it here, and this is the next step there. So here we have from LH2 to LH2 to LH1, and then to the reaction center. So that is the energy transfer. And now comes five, that the excitation, the electronic excitation, is used for electron transfer. So this is happens in the reaction center. So this is a really the first real key process, because now the system is turning the energy of the photon. First, that was in electronic excitation of the molecules, and now it turns it into electron transfer, charging the membrane, plus here, negative there. Now the way that goes now, however, is that the electron is actually not left alone there, because it would go any place and conduct through tunneling in an uncontrolled way. It is placed on a molecule called quinone to make it turn it into a molecule called quinol by adding to the two electrons two protons. So you have two protons, two electrons, they are meaning to have two hydrogen atoms, and you are turning now the molecule with O's here into a molecule that has here OH and OH. I don't draw the molecules the best way for a chemistry or a physical chemistry student. So forgive me if you are an expert there. It's not that I'm just a dumb physicist, dumb with chemistry, but rather I don't want to go into the detail at this point. So that's what you do. And now this molecule visits now another molecule in the membrane called the BC1 complex. Complex because it's made of several proteins, not just one protein. And here what happens is that the quinol becomes a quinone. So with other words, it must give off its electrons and protons. And that is in fact happening. Now the way I draw it is here, the way a dumb person would do it. But it's better that I simplify now, and I say just one in a second, say something else about it. So the electrons go here. These are the electrons, two electrons. And they are now being taken on by a molecule cytochrome, actually one electron at a time, that has exactly this molecule too, but with an ion in there, so that it that is a better conductor or container of electrons. And this goes here to the reaction center. It helicopters, literally goes down, takes the electron, helicopters over, goes down, gives the electron here, so that the electrons go here back, so that the reaction center can start fresh again, because the electrons have been replenished. And meanwhile, the protons go also to the other side. So now the electrons are circular, so basically if we only had the electron flow, we would have lost all our energy. But now we picked up the protons and put them to the other side, and now we have a proton gradient. We still have plus here, more protons here, and less protons here. So we have now then the electron transfer. And now this electron transfer is also several electron transfers with a tetrapyrrole ring. That has actually an ion in the middle, the heme. And so there can be ion 2 plus or 3 plus. And the ion can also be in a high spin state or a low spin state. There we can all have different kind of containers for electrons. And we have several electron transfers with the ion, or with actually also an interesting arrangement. This is not quite the arrangement that you have in bacterial photosynthesis, but it's such a beautiful arrangement that I don't draw it. You have iron, sulfur, iron, sulfur, iron, sulfur. So you see that you have a box made of half of the vertices are sulfur, half of them are iron. So they are also very good in containing, they're called iron sulfur centers. They're also very good in conducting electrons. So you have really a real sophisticated machinery of electron conduction there. That is quite impressive. And it's as good as what you find in solid state physics. Okay, good. So that is what you get. And then finally, we generate proton gradient. And then eight is use proton gradient for for ATP synthesis. So, can somebody take a picture? Anybody have, of my people have their phones here? They take my phone, take a picture of the board. You have one, okay, good. So, okay, so now let me put where this is. Here we have a cylinder that sits in the system, and as the protons go back in energy from the positive to the negative side, the cylinder is put into rotation. That is connected to an eccentric axle that sits in the big protein element that mechanically now turns ADP into ATP. And that is the end of the story. And then we have turned the light energy into ATP. And so now the quantum biology that involves electrons is really, it's really this piece. This is really quantum biology. Protons are actually halfway quantum particles. Everything is, of course, a quantum particle, but the quantum effects are not really that significant. But for the electron, they are just absolutely essential. Classical effects are insignificant. And so this is a quantum biology that we need to understand. Now, we say, oh, this sounds sort of okay, good, fine, but why should I care? Now, you can ask the question, why should I care, from two points of views. One is as a biologist. You know, you may think every biologist is interested in photosynthesis, but if you go over to life science, ask them how much they know about photosynthesis. Biology is a much bigger field as physics. You know, there are so many different species, and if you go over there, you find very few are interested in photosynthesis. So why should they care anyway? The reason is that, for example, spectra to identify molecules through light absorption is very, very common. In many laboratories where people don't care at all about photosynthesis, but light absorption to identify through the spectra molecules, either when they absorb the light or fluoresce the light, is very, very common. I would say 50% of all the labs use some fluorescence. And if they want to improve it, they need to understand it. So if you're a biologist, this is already enough reason, just light absorption and fluorescence. Why you want to understand it. Electron transfer is very fundamental to many, many biological processes. Only the absolute most primitive organisms do relatively little, but also they do electron transfer. But any higher animal do all the energetics with electron transfer, like we humans have electron transfer chain that are just the same as in photosynthesis. And so if you want to understand, I would say a third of all our metabolic pathways, in particular the most important ones that give us energy, we need to understand electron transfer. So even if you don't care about photosynthesis, you are a medical person, many diseases go wrong because of electron transfer. So with other words, the quantum biology is not just something special. Now, why should you care when you are a physicist or an engineer or chemist? You say, oh yeah, photosynthesis, I have to learn about it because this is one of the cafeteria courses in physics, and that way I can pass my requirement. That is a good answer, but the other answer is that, again, light absorption, fluorescence methods, electron transfer, with molecules is a very hot subject in many fields. Not in Loomis maybe, but for the totally the wrong reasons. Physicists study something. He puts his sample on the dish and pours over it liquid nitrogen or liquid helium to make everything calm down, and you will take some very odd solid material nobody ever knows about it. They maybe don't even know themselves what's really the structure of it is and so on, but it shows some fascinating, amazing superconductivity at very low temperature, where the world is not working, and with material that are extremely toxic and arise very rarely. Here we talk molecules. They are all over the place. That is where the hot stuff is today. They are nanometric size, and one of our hottest laboratories, our laboratory for nanoscale technology. And so this is the stuff that you need to know, how molecules conduct electrons, not how some strange solids conduct molecules, how conduct electrons, and how not these strange solids absorb light. You need to know this one. If you go to the real world, you will realize that we are the ones, our graduates, what course did you miss most when you went actually into life as a real physicist beyond the academic world? And the answer was the science of molecules, because all the materials they deal with, they had no clue what they are dealing with, because they never learned it. So here you learn something very important beyond biology. All the nano world uses molecules rather than solids.
Professor Schulten, in step number two, the energy transfer between the carotenoids and the chlorophylls, that's photon energy transfer.
That is?
Photon energy transfer? Vibrational energy transfer?
No. This is electronic energy transfer. Yes. So an electronic excitation of a carotenoid becomes an electronic excitation of the chlorophyll.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And one more question: the two hydrogen protons that you had inside, those are always there. They don't need to get replenished.
Excuse me.
Those protons don't need to get replenished.
The protons
inside the membrane.
Yes.
Where do they come from? They're always there.
The protons inside the membrane. Yeah. So basically, roughly speaking, life is around neutral pH, which is 10 to the minus 7, what is it exactly, mole per liter of protons. So the concentration, 10 minus 7 sounds very small, but mole per liter, mole is 10 to the 24 particles. So you have many, many protons in a liter of a cell, of course, doesn't have a liter, but you have many, many thousands of protons in the cell, outside and inside. And now you change the concentration a little bit. You pump them from the outside to the inside, but there's a sea of protons outside that you can use for the purpose, and there are already many waiting inside. You just put a few more. So there's a big party going on of many protons in normal water and in cells and cell water and so on. Other questions? Okay, so now we have to address this, and this is physics. The word quantum biology indicates that already, so now we need to do it. So did you take a picture now? Okay, then let's begin with the physics. So the starting point is, of course, the molecules interact with the radiation field. And so now we need to describe the radiation field. And then once we have described the radiation field, or actually maybe I'll just say the electromagnetic properties of the space in which the bacteria live, then we can study how the electromagnetic environment interacts with the molecules. So first we just deal with the behavior, the electromagnetic behavior of the habitat of a proper bacterium. So here we have, let's say, the proper bacterium. Here we have the sun, and here we have the radiation field that goes through the space between the sun and Earth and goes to the surface of the Earth and then goes through the bacterium. And the bacterium is made of molecules. Or maybe I draw the molecule here, molecule 1, molecule 2, molecule 3, molecule 4. 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so on, and they interact with the light, and that's what we want to describe. But before we describe the interaction, we need to describe the radiation field, or the radiation field, or the electromagnetic environment. Okay, the physics of the radiation field is, of course, based on the Maxwell equations. And so we have to start with the Maxwell equations. So there are four Maxwell equations. The first two are called the inhomogeneous Maxwell equations. And they are called divergence E is equal to 4 pi the charge density around the system, and the rotation B minus dTE is equal to 4 pi the current density around the system. So you can have charges that are, you can have charges that can, of course, move and also generate a current. But you can also have a current that doesn't have a charge. For example, if a dipole antenna, then, you know, the current goes through the dipole antenna like this and this and this. And you have a current but no charge. That's completely possible. And then you have also contribution to the, that is the source of the electromagnetic field. Okay, then we have a rotation E plus time derivative of B is zero, and then we have the divergence of B is zero. So those are the homogeneous Maxwell equations. Okay, and so now we want to solve it, and we call the equations 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, and we begin actually with 4, the equation 4. So what I do now is an absolute minimum of describing how we get the solution. Don't worry now that we are now having the next 2 weeks on electromagnetic theory. So up to the minimum, but, you know, not less than the minimum for this. Okay, so this equation, divergence B, can it be solved automatically if we choose B of the form that B is actually the rotation of a vector potential A of R and T. So there's A is a vector field. At every point in time, in space, we assign a vector. And if we now take the rotation of that, then we are getting B. And now one can show immediately that the divergence of a rotation is always zero. no matter what A is, and so we automatically have solved equation 4. Okay, that's good. And now it turns out equation 3 likewise can be solved automatically, so that we can totally forget about them by just putting our newly found wisdom here, and it reads now rotation of E plus dTa is 0. So now we have so basically what I did is I first had a term, but I don't want to go into the derivation. So this is all very nicely derived in the notes that you got. You go there, the notes are very fair in being as simple as possible. Don't read the things that are not relevant to you. You might get totally confused and upset with yourself. But if you read the parts that are relevant, you will find they explain things nicely, if you want to know the explanation. So now we have basically here something that looks a little bit like this one, where we call this one, you know, quantity that we want to simplify. And the way we do that is by putting now E plus dTa. We use a similar trick, except this time we make it the gradient of a scalar function. So now we have a scalar function at every point in space. We give what we actually later call a potential energy. And so just one value, a scalar value. And then this one automatically satisfies this equation, because the rotation of a gradient of a scalar is always 0. So automatically satisfies 3. So satisfies 3. And we can, of course, write this one also simply as E is equal to minus gradient V minus dTa. Okay, good. So now we have automatically replaced these two equations by introducing now two new quantities, namely A and V. And the fields can be written in terms of these quantities. Now this may seem to be just a little bit like a stupid trick of one of those elegantissimo theoretical physicists, but you will find out, maybe not today anymore, but maybe even at the end of the lecture today, that the quantum mechanical treatment of the electrons, the quantum mechanical treatment of the electrons with a radiation field, with E and B, does not involve E and B, it involves actually A and V. So we need them anyway. Here we just introduce them to make our life easier, but later we need them. We need them. Okay, so now we could ask ourselves, is this choice of A and B, A and V, unique? So is the relationship between E and B and A and V unique? And the answer is no. The answer is it's not unique. Now that turns out to be then, it depends always how you look at things, it turns out to be maybe really bad, but it's really good, as we will see in a second. So you can actually convince yourself that when you change A by A plus gradient, the new function chi is now a scalar function of R and T, and V by V minus dT chi, then E and B remain the same. So the relation is not unique, and you can choose, there are many choices. And now we can choose, we can take advantage of this. This is all very nicely derived in the notes, it's also extremely well known. In physics you call that gauge freedom. We can take advantage of this freedom. So this is called the gauge freedom. By imposing that the divergence of A is zero. So we choose a vector field with one particular property, that its divergence is zero. That means that you don't have a vector field that comes, for example, at any point, it seems to radiate from a black hole in the space, or opposite goes into that. No, it only goes round. It doesn't ever go into certain, comes from a point or goes to a point. And so now questions about the one, who knows what the how you calculate the divergence? Or who doesn't know it? Okay, good, so then there we are safe. Who doesn't know how to calculate the rotation? And who doesn't know how to calculate, divergence, gradient? Okay, good, so then it's defined in the notes, and you may also go to the Google and get the definitions. Okay, good, so now, we need to take advantage of these equations. And for now we go to equation one and write equation one. And for now we have E is equal to the equation one reads now divergence of gradient of V with a minus sign. That's our first term, and then we have minus dt divergence of A. So I just use now this equation here. That is our left hand side is equal to four pi rho. Now if I look here, then the divergence of A is zero. That's how we have chosen it. So this term drops out. So we are getting only here the term minus, we call now this operator divergence gradient. We call it this one, or very often you also call it this one, the Laplace operator. Or the x squared plus the y squared plus the z squared. And so we have now this equation, and if I, you permit me now that I draw now this, and we have here, we put a plus sign here, a v here, and a minus sign, and that is called Laplace equation. That's a very, very famous equation, the first equation that you encounter in undergraduate electromagnetism, and the solution, in case that you don't have any boundaries in your system, you don't have a metal plate somewhere or an insulating plate or something, anything fishy, then the solution is very famous, and you know it already, even though you may not realize it. And the solution is V of R and T is equal to integral d r prime, the volume integral over the volume of your space. In this case, the whole universe, there is no boundary. And then we have rho of r prime and t divided by r minus a prime. And the underscore means here, of course, all this three-dimensional vector. So this is a famous Coulomb formula. And now some of you might be offended, some physicists. Any physicist? Who is a physicist here? Okay, so you might be offended. Maybe you could be offended because if the charge distribution over there and changes, then immediately at the place here, r prime is in that corner, r is here, the potential changes. So that means that this description is not wrong. It's not wrong. It's just not everything yet. We didn't say anything about A yet. So A will repair this, but this particular part of our description is not relativistically invariant. It has to be relativistically invariant because the Maxwell equation are, so there's something missing in the A coming there. But you know this one. But for a biologist, that is totally fine because processes are so slow that relativistic effects do not play a big role. So one of my graduate students had a hard time with a qual. She didn't get enough right on the I have a group in biological physics, and she couldn't get the relativity equations answered well. And then the committee said, oh, she has to take a course in relativity. And I was exploding. And saying, how can you force my students to take a course in relativity? Really doesn't, it's not the most, the least important course she needs. Today, actually, she's the health administrator. So it's true that she never needed relativity. Then I decided, okay, let's just be quiet, and probably the department forgets about it, and that was the case, so they never came back and made her take the course, and so she got her PhD without relativity. But in some other cases, you need relativity, then you have magnetic effects, and one of my specialties actually to study bird navigation in the geomagnetic field, where that is just pure relativity, special relativity that is necessary. Though some places of homology need it. But anyway, here we have a non-relativistic part of the description. Okay, so now we know then the V, but we don't know yet the A. So then we go to the other equation. So the other equation is it's this equation. So we have to now write here rotation of A. B is rotation A, so like this. And then we have plus, and now we have dt. And then we have, E, just E. And E is gradient V with the minus, and then minus dt squared A is equal to 4 pi j of r and t. Okay, so this is the equation. And this is not a nice equation because the V, that's pretty complicated, appears here. And it is not easy to deal with. However, you can show that this term is actually contained here too. J has some currents that you call the transverse currents that are these dipole antennas, where no charge, you have nowhere net charge, but you have a current. So you have a current. So I don't want to go there into here. But then you also have a current that comes around through these guys moving from rho dot. And now you can, what you can do is you can take this term, subtract that current from this current, then you can take it away and replace this one only by longitudinal, by the transverse current. And so now you have only the current that are dipole antennas. And the current due to the movement of charges, you have already here accounted for, and you don't have to worry about it anymore. So if somebody asks, what is your J, then you say, oh, that rho dot part, it's only in the molecule. I only give you now the current that is the dipole antenna current. And okay, then we don't have this anymore, and we have solved our problem. Now the equation here, we could solve this equation, this inhomogeneous equation. Here we still have the inhomogeneous equation, but the currents from the solar radiation, they're all on the sun. When the radiation comes from the sun through outer space to the Earth, the radiation is the same. Of course, it can be slightly affected if it goes by a dipole antenna of the real radio station or something, but you know, this is sort of secondary effect. The pure situation is there's no effect. So this current here is zero for all practical purposes, because the sun makes its radiation, but once it sends the radiation, yes, the radiation can be a little bit modified, but that's not the real essential physics point. And so we have now to solve the equation, this equation. Now this equation here has two terms. One term is, you can write that this one is a gradient of divergence of A minus the Laplace operator of A. Oh, what is that? Laplace operator always acts on the scalar. Now this is the Laplace operator acting on the x component of A, on the y component of A, and on the z component of A. That's what you mean by this. And now if I put this equation together, then I have the following equation. Laplace operator A, I take the minus sign, I multiply everything by the minus sign, so that becomes the plus sign, plus a minus, here it is, this becomes the plus. No. Sorry. That should be a plus here, this one here. This one? Okay, thank you, Nicole. I needed the sign. So minus dt squared A is equal to zero. So that is the equation do I get. And now this has also a famous name and a famous solution. This is a wave equation. And the solution of this equation, there are many types of solution, but this is a solution that is, you can have many what you call basis sets and form of solutions, or you can write them. And one is that the generic solution is A is equal to A0 times a vector U, a unit vector, times e to the I k dot r minus plus omega t. So that is, if you put it in there, you can convince yourself it's a solution. But there will be a condition, and you will find it, you have a condition that omega squared is equal k squared. With other words, you have, for omega, you have two signs, either plus or minus sign, both is a solution. and I put the minus sign first over the plus sign for a very good reason that will become apparent in a second. Because the minus sign is a more natural sign, little bit, than the plus sign. That's why I put the minus sign first. Okay, so this is it, and now this is our U, and now we say scratch, 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 we put it into there, but how about the divergence of A equals zero? If we test this one, we say, yeah, we can make it whole, but we have to have a condition that that unit vector is perpendicular to K. Okay, no problem there. And so this is our solution. And now we would like to interpret the solution. And now we first have a little bit of a problem. First I have to tell you now quickly the fields. So the field is B is equal rotation A, and it equal to I omega IK cross A. If you do it, I want to check that I don't make a mistake. So, and then we have for E, we have now a little bit of an odd thing. E is equal to E transverse plus E longitudinal, and E longitudinal is actually minus gradient V. So we redefine our E here. The E that comes from this, we call now E longitudinal, and the real E that corrects the relativity problem there is actually a sum of two E's, an EL and an ET. And the ET is minus DTA. Okay, good. And if I calculate it, then I find this is minus plus. Let me be sure that I get it right, plus minus I omega A. Okay, and so now, I know the E, I know all the fields, and I've all everything solved. But now I would like to also get the interpretation of this solution. What does this solution stand for? The potential we know pretty well, but here we also know, if you took your course in electromagnetism, you know it, but it looks like in the department actually electromagnetism is one of the weakest fields of the graduate students. You guys have to learn there. And so it's good that you maybe get here a brush up. Even a biophysicist knows more about electromagnetism than you guys. Okay, so let's now interpret it. And the way we interpret it is by looking at the pointing vector. Let me see that I write that right. Pointing vector. And the pointing vector is defined as S equal 1 over 4 pi. Don't copy it yet. Don't copy it. Just copy it in a second. Equals cross. Don't copy it yet. B. So this is a pointing vector, but the pointing vector is actually a physical observable that tells you how much energy is flowing in the system connected with that radiation field. And this is a real quantity, but this one here is a complex field. Fields are not complex. Now it turns out that you can calculate with these complex things all the time. You do all the algebra, except when you calculate an observable, like the pointing vector. Then you must put the real part of the field in there to get it right. So whenever you calculate everything, all the anyway, yeah. So here we put the real part of this and the real part of this. Otherwise, it's fine. Just use of my formula. Yeah. Okay. So if you do that, and then you find that the radiation here is oscillating. I didn't interpret the frequency yet, but the frequency is very, very high. It's 10 to the 15 for radiation that is absorbed by molecules. Oh, I'm already too late. It's absorbed by molecules. Then you want to not look at one omega. You want to look at an average of S over time about 10 to the minus 15 seconds. The average over 10 to the minus 15 seconds. Pretty okay. And what you find is now, and I stop here and then I continue next time, when you put it all in, it's all very nicely derived. And you know what you find? And it's plus minus. Here we have minus plus. Now it's plus minus omega squared divided by 4 pi times A0 squared times k, the unit vector k, the unit vector. And now we see that the k is very important. The k gives us a direction in which the energy flows with the radiation. You often call it just also the direction of the radiation. And when we have a minus here, then the energy goes in the plus direction towards the target, and that is absorption. Whereas when we put a plus here, then the energy comes from the target, and then this is emission. So we're getting a different direction of energy flow depending on what sign we choose. Okay, so now we are basically through the whole formalism, and next time we apply them to the molecules. So the radiation field we have now basically cornered, and then we apply to the molecules, and then we get in already the formulas for the absorption of radiation, emission of radiation, and have a real fun studying how the molecules like chlorophylls. And carotenoids absorb radiation. Like, for example, we do next time already, why do other molecules that interact with sunlight so big? Why don't they make little atoms or even shorter ones? Why are they so big? They are so big because of H bar, the value of H bar, the value of E, the value of the electron mass, dictates the size of the molecule. They have to be between 10 and 20 angstrom wide in order to absorb sunlight. It's just basic physics. And so that we will be learning. Anyway, thank you very much for your attention.